that I've been sitting in your shoes. And when I was asked to prepare to speak to you today about human resource management, I remembered what it was like sitting in your shoes. And to be honest, I had two or three questions that was on my mind all the time. One is, what am I going to do in the next few months while I'm at school? And how much fun I'm going to have in college? And the third question is, what am I going to do with my life? And it is a point where you start thinking through what is next steps look like? What am I going to eventually do? I'm going to leave home, your comfort zone, et cetera, et cetera. So for the sake of today's presentation, I will not answer the first two questions, but I will focus on the third, is what am I going to do in life? And I want to leave you with two main takeaways. One is, I'm going to share a concept to help you think through your decision about this exciting journey, what to do, what is next. And I will reflect through my experience over the past 20 years, what is HR, and I'll try to help you answer a few questions. I want you to hear from the experts, what are the HR building blocks, and what does it take to be an HR person? So without any further ado, I will jump into the first part, which was a difficult part for me to navigate. And it's never easy and it's never so quick. And it takes time for it to develop. I'm not sure if you're familiar or have seen the concept of ikigai before. It's a Japanese concept meaning a reason for being. And it specifically speaks through four main dimensions that help you really find your purpose. What are you meant to do? And the first one is, what do you love to do? What are you good at? What makes you tick? What touches you? What you enjoy doing? And then the second part is, what are you good at? Think about your unique talents that you have. What do people give you compliments on? What comes natural and easy to you? What experience have you gained? And then the third one is, what can I do that I'm good at and I love, but I can get paid for? And what does the world really need? How can I make an impact? Is there something helpful you can do for others? How can you contribute to the world? What activities are there that would have a positive effect on the world? What can my children or people after me be proud of what I did? And this concept in general, the intersection of this concept is where the Japanese early thinking and gurus say that you've reached your purpose or your ikigai. And this does not happen overnight. You know, you start by thinking of what you love and what you're good at. And the intersection between these two points is where you find your passion. The cross-section of what you're good at and what you can be paid for is where you find a profession, a career, something that you can build on and keep on getting money from. The intersection between what you're good at and what the world needs is vocation. And vocation differs from a profession because vocation doesn't really need that much training or education. So the world needs carpenters and you can get paid. That's a vocation. Now, if I focus on what the world needs and what you love, you can achieve your mission. And somewhere within all these intersections is a space that helps you get closer to this purpose, but still not 100% there. The intersection of all three, what you love, what you're good at, and what you can get paid for, is where you are satisfied, but feeling useless. How am I going to contribute to the world? There's still a missing piece closer to your purpose, but you're still missing a piece. If we look at the intersection between what you're paid for, what you're good at, and what the world needs, you become comfortable, but you slightly feel emptiness. This is nothing that I love. This is not something that I would love to spend the rest of my life doing. looking at the intersection of what you love, what you need, and what you're paid for gives you excitement, but complacency and a sense of uncertainty. I'm not very good at this job. You know, it's exciting, I'm getting paid for it, but you know, what if, and what if? What if I found something better I can do? This concept in general, when it touches on love, needs, and what you're good at, you feel delighted, you feel fullness, but you know what? You don't have money. So it is a fine intersection between four different building blocks that can help you find your purpose and the reason for your being and what are you supposed to do. And perhaps these are some of the most crucial questions you will come across in your life, in your journey. This doesn't happen overnight. This is nothing that you can sit on a desk today and plan over the next 10 years, but you can take active steps in getting you closer to understanding what you're meant to be doing. And this is why I was very excited to join you today. And I would like to share my experience and reflect, how did these questions help me answer the path of human resource management? So from your desk to date, I actually am an alumni of NES. I graduated class of 2000. I did my A-levels in physics, maths, economics, and Arabic. I was on the football team, and I played rugby for Jordan for about 5 years of my life. And I share some of these instances with you to help you think through how I was able to answer those questions. But primarily, I was interested in three P's. You know, people, performance, and potential. People, performance, and potential. I loved helping people. I loved giving advice, coaching, motivating them, problem solving. It felt like I had a sticker on my head every time any of my friends come around. You know, what should we do with this or that? I was very interested with performance, being a sports person, you know, being on teams. I learned teamwork, collaboration. I learned for you to improve and achieve your goals, you got to work hard. You got to train and work hard more to help you get to the standards that you want. And I was always fascinated by the concept of, what if I do 1, 2, 3? Will it help me get closer? What is my potential? What am I eventually going to reach? What am I going to do? So needless to say, like anyone graduating, you start looking for college. And this is where I went to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. I had a scholarship and I studied my bachelor's in international management and computer information systems. I focus on some of the jobs that I did. And, you know, as an international student in the United States, you're only allowed to work on campus. So I took on many roles, a teacher's assistant, a supplementary instructor, a tutor. I even worked in university security. And that was for the extra money for the first two questions that we will not attend to today. From my bachelor's, I graduated in 2003. I was working still in teachers as a teacher's assistant, a supplementary instructor, a tutor. And my boss at the time had quit. So they asked me to fill her position in 2003 while I was still a senior in college. I had many practical coursework that I applied directly on my job. As a tutor, we used to book appointments back in the time over the phone. So I quickly helped develop with the IT support a system where you can book appointments, get a tutor and a student together, submit your payroll, et cetera, et cetera. After that first project, they offered me the job while I was still in school, and I started working. I worked in academic enrichment. I was helping socioeconomic underprepared kids, students that came first time to college, students whose scores weren't as good as it was meant or hoped to be. With my affiliation to athletes, I started working on the student athletes program, student activities, and I became more interested in the same three P's that started with people, performance, and potential. How can I help those students achieve their potential? I had a fantastic advisor at the time, and I started playing more with the questions and asking her, what can I do? What is my purpose? What am I supposed to do in life? I like this, I like that. And she began to tell me a little bit more about human resource management and the concept of being able to make an impact on the most competitive, sustainable advantage any organization has, which is their people. And I did my master's in human resource management, and I focused on organizational development and change, which is performance. How can I get a place from here to there? What does it need to change? I graduated in 2008, and I continued working in higher education. But then I started looking up what's next and what is my job after this. And I was fortunate to land a job at Hay Group, or Korn Ferry today. Hay Group is a management and HR consulting firm. And this was the first real interaction of HR with the world. 9 years after I graduated, having done physics, math, economics, and Arabic, international management and computer information systems, I ended up doing HR consulting. And some of my best colleagues that were so good at what they did were actually industrial engineers or psychologists by trade. So it's not necessarily that what you pick and what you do define how you will end up working. And many jobs don't necessarily depend on the profession itself. It's the experience, the interests, and a combination of what you can do that can help you. Obviously, this is not true if you're a doctor or an engineer where, you know, your trade or profession requires that specific training. In consulting, in Hay Group, this, and I would like to spend a little more time speaking about this, we've done many things. We answered very big questions to CEOs. How can I improve my performance? What can I do to get the right talent? How can I improve my culture? What does it take to perform better as an organization? How can we increase our net profit, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera? We worked on organizational effectiveness projects, restructuring, privatization of organizations. We worked on an example, Saudi Airlines. We did, they had 13 salary scales. They wanted a unified way that pays people fairly. We did restructuring of the Ministry of Education. We worked on master human resource planning for the country of Saudi Arabia. We've done nationalization agendas. We helped family businesses pick the next successor. So a family business has 8 sons. Who should succeed me after I leave? Tough questions around people and performance and, in general, organizational effectiveness. From there, and I'm sorry I didn't add this milestone, you know, this consulting world requires a lot of travel, requires a lot of time when you leave the client site in terms of what to do. I got married in 2012, and that travel and lifestyle could not really sustain with the new changes in my life. So one of my clients was British Petroleum, and British Petroleum owns a lubricants division called Castrol. And I mean, some of you might, if you watched the World Cup in 2004, Castrol was the official sponsor at the time, in 2014, apologies. And I was doing work for BP. We created the strategy for this new division for them in Saudi Arabia in terms of going to market and being successful. And somehow they offered me the role of transforming that newly set business and work on improving HR. So we've done everything from how do we organize ourselves? What's the best structure? What's the route to market? How do we get it prepared? How do we change the sales incentive schemes? How do we pay people, etc.? How do we help them develop their skills and capabilities to be able to deliver against the Castrol promise? I spent 3 years there, and we achieved fantastic outcomes. One thing in oil and gas is that the nature of the jobs are not necessarily our professionals. You have people in factories, you have people in rigs, you have people in lower or you know, white collar and blue collar labor, more on the labors and the salespeople. I wanted to experience what would it take to be able to make that difference for a more professional services organization. So I moved to Epicorp, where I am currently the director of HR and corporate affairs. And in my capacity, I look after HR, corporate communication, administration, procurement, and we own a couple of facilities that I help run. Epicorp is a multilateral, owned by 10 Arab oil exporting countries, and it focuses on the transformation of the energy industry through providing tailored financial solutions. So HR exists everywhere. HR exists in every organization. The type of the organization and the life cycle of the organization has direct impact on the role of HR within this space. So let me take you and actually dig a little more.
Thank you, Mr. Felix. Mr. Hamdi, you have a question. If you go back in time, would you study something different at school or university?
Actually, no. And somehow, as I said, I did so many different topics in A-level and my bachelor's degree. But if you heard Felix as he spoke, and his slides mentioned passion, love, want to make an impact, good at what he does, and learned his lessons. At the end of the day, any of the examples he even shared, in my opinion, the only sustainable advantage any of these companies have, yes, they had a fantastic idea and understood the gaps in the market, but at the end of the day, it's their people that made the difference, and it's their people that will drive that sustained performance over time. HR has evolved over time, and the role of HR has evolved to help the likes of Felix in entrepreneurship to be able to be successful is to understand their passion, what they're good at, what they want to do, what's their potential, and how can they seize the opening in the market and the opportunity to make that difference. And he can get paid while he's doing so. So these are the four areas where we touched on at the beginning of the presentation. And no, I mean, I was passionate about performance, people, and potential, and HR has fulfilled all these three areas.
Okay, thank you. We have one more question, and I think this would be aimed to Mr. Hamdi. What do you think of business in Jordan?
Look, the Middle East region, I wouldn't just specify it to Jordan, has evolved over time. We've learned best practice, we've learned how to do things, but we actually had a fantastic opportunity to see others do it and fail and learn from their mistakes and lessons, whereby the last 10 to 15 years, the region has saw tremendous improvement in how they do business, not only from what they are trying to do, but the impact of it and how they're doing it. And business have improved tremendously over the past 20 or so years in the Middle East in general, and Jordan the same. It's a shame in Jordan, and I have to, the amount of talent we outsource elsewhere. And Jordan's biggest challenge is to be able to realize the human capital that they have and be able to retain it and use it for within the country to help it develop further. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of work that is required.
Mm-hmm. And hopefully we will progress. And that is the end of our session. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining us. We really appreciate it, and we did benefit a lot. So hopefully we can be as successful as you two are someday. Thank you very much, and hopefully we can catch up soon. Thank you.
Thank you so much.